Sunday school vision is simple. It is to share, teach, and live the story of Jesus Christ. We take that everywhere we go. Your presence is important to us, so please fill out one of our new information cards and place it in the offering plate later in the service. We want to get to know you.
Nice job, Mac. Welcome to our 14th annual Children's Sabbath. Yes, this is the day that we get to take over. Today is a celebration of the many children who have, over the years, filled this place with noise, fingerprints, scuff marks, and lots of love. It is a joy and a privilege to join them on their faith walk. We want to give a special shout out to two faces you won't see during worship. Working behind the scenes today, Jay Spiel and Zarek Zelmansky are serving in the tech booth, so give them a wave up there. Yeah. There is something new in the seat back in front of you. We have replaced the old welcome cards with the new improved information card that Mac just mentioned that can be used by everyone in the congregation, not just visitors. You can submit a prayer request, update your address or other contact information, or share any information you would like to with us. Just fill out this handy new card and place it in the offering plate. Later on, when we pass the friendship pads, don't do it now, you will notice that they are also updated, making them easier to complete.
In a moment, you will see a video of our youngest Sunday school students reciting a Bible verse they have been practicing. As you listen, you will be reminded of the special love Jesus has for children.
God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. That's what we've been doing every week. So we're going to do that again. We're going to do it a couple times so we can get it on video, okay? Need to say it as loud as you say the good part, okay? When you do good, you're gonna do this. But I need your voices just like for the good part, okay? So Genesis 1:31. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. So I know you know it, so say it as loud as you can, okay?
Okay.
All right.
God saw all that he had made. It was very good.
All right. I love your enthusiasm. That is awesome, but we got to start at the beginning, okay? We got to start with Genesis 1:31. Okay. So, loud from the beginning. Genesis 1:31. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. Genesis 1:31. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good.
As we prepare to lead today's worship, please silence your cell phones. Thank you for joining your hands with us today. Again, we are so happy you are here.
Power,
Good morning. I invite you to put the events of the week behind you and prepare your hearts for worship. Listen to the word of the Lord from the book of Proverbs. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. Friends, let us worship God together.
Please stand as we sing My Lighthouse.
My lighthouse,
Please stay standing.
Please remain standing if you are able, and join me as we affirm what we believe by saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth of the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We would like to invite everyone to greet one another right now, and we would like to invite the adults only to come join us on the steps for moments with the adults. Don't be shy. Enough of this Christian fellowship. Everybody have a seat. You guys take up a lot of room. No offense. Well, good morning, boys and girls. Let's try that again. Good morning, boys and girls. Much better. You may know the Placer boys here, Hugo and Nestor. Hugo, can you tell me what stewardship season is?
Yes, it's when the church makes its giving back to God plans for the next year.
Right, good job. So this year the church has decided to go with a Star Wars theme to promote stewardship season. It's a great idea since there's a new Star Wars movie coming out. Nestor, I understand that you have a question for our friends here.
Please raise your hand if you saw the first Star Wars movies in 1977.
In 1977. All right, I'm a little depressed. I see a couple down there not raising their hands. I was out of high school then. Okay, boys, you are very mature fourth graders, but don't look now, but there's a bunch of third graders behind you, and I think they have something to say. They're actually going to tie this Star Wars thing in with the stewardship thing. So you have a step right over there, and let's hear what Princess Leia has to say.
Princess Leia said, "I am not a committee."
Stewardship translation?
We have to work together, people.
Good job. Next.
Yoda said, "Judge me by my size." Do you?
Stewardship translation?
Kids can give back to God, too.
Awesome. Okay. Sit up, honey.
Luke Skywalker said, "It's your choice, but I warn you not to underestimate my power."
Stewardship translation?
Kids can give back to God too.
That's what she said. Yeah.
Han Solo said, "Never tell me the odds."
Stewardship translation?
This may not be easy, but we can do it.
Nice job.
Darth Vader said, "I find your lack of faith disturbing."
Stewardship translation?
This may not be easy, but we can do it.
That's what she said.
One stormtrooper said, "We do other things besides look for droids, but that's all anyone ever remembers."
Stewardship translation?
Yeah, kids can be loud and messy, but we have a heart for God too.
Nice job. Let's see what we have back here.
C-3PO said, "Thank the Maker."
Stewardship translation?
It's all about God.
Nice.
If we could understand R2-D2, we would hear this. Let's get the job done and get it done right.
Stewardship translation?
Let's do this for God's kingdom.
Awesome.
If we could understand Chewbacca, we would hear this. Strength and loyalty are what count.
Stewardship translation?
Let's give back to God who is faithful and strong for us each day.
Obi-Wan Kenobi said, "May the Force be with you."
Stewardship translation?
Let the power of the Holy Spirit guide your living and your giving.
Nice job. You're living and you're giving. Nice job, you guys. Okay.
Let's all pray together.
Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you so much.
For blessing us
in so many ways.
Please help all of us
to build your kingdom
here on earth.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
May the Force be with you.
Nice job. Boys and girls, you have been wonderful listeners. Now go back to your seats, please.
Please stand as we sing Oceans. Oh.
Please pray with me. Dear God, we thank you for blessing us as we grow in your word. We thank you for our parents and the adults in our lives who guide us in so many ways. Please keep our feet on the path you would have us follow.
We bring you prayers for healing, for those on our prayer list, and for all people in need. Please be with those who need your help at home, at work, and at school. Please be with those who are sad and lonely and bring them your peace and comfort.
Please watch over our country and guide our leaders to the right decisions, those that will help us to grow as one nation under God. We pray for guidance for the leaders of this nation and all nations. Please bring peace where there is war.
Please help us to take care of this beautiful green earth you have entrusted to us. Help us to be good stewards of the resources of the environment so that our generation and those to come will have fresh air and clean water.
And now let us weave our prayers together, saying the prayer that Jesus taught his friends. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory forever. Amen.
At this time, please find a friendship pad at the end of your row. Take a moment to sign your name and pass it on. When it reaches the end of your row, pass it back so that we can learn the names of our neighbors. Your presence is important to us, and now let us give back to God as he has given to us.
Please stand if you are able for our doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings.
Please pray with me. Dear God, we thank you for these gifts. With joy, we give them back to you. Please gather them to just the right places to help those in need and to bring glory to your name. And now, please open our ears and our hearts so that we may hear the message today. Let us grow in your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The Old Testament reading for today is Psalm 1, verses 1 through 3. It can be found on page 383 in the Pew Bible. Listen to the word of the Lord. Blessed is the man who does not walk on the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted in streams of water, which yields fruit in the season, and on his leaf he does not wither. Whatever he does, he prospers. This is the word of the Lord.
New Testament reading for today is Philippians 3, verses 8 through 9. It can be found on page 832 in the Pew Bible. Listen to the word of the Lord. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, but not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. Listen to the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Great job. All right. It's sermon time. We're in an Armor of God series going through the different aspects of the armor. And I want to remind all of us Christians that we are engaged in a battle against the evil forces that are trying to stop us from bringing Christ's grace to as many people as possible. And the Lord has a battle plan, and he's given us the tools to achieve a victory. And last week we talked about the belt of truth, that we stand on everything that Jesus said. And today we're going to talk about the breastplate of righteousness. Now, the breastplate was a bronze shield that went over your chest. It was from your waist up to your neck. It had leather on the inside. It was bronze on the outside. And what it did is it would protect your vital organs from somebody trying to stab you with a sword or shooting an arrow at you or throwing a javelin. And Paul aligns righteousness with this essential piece of armor. Now, let's be honest, righteous is an outdated word. I mean, I grew up in the 70s when somebody was cool, you know, we said he was a righteous dude, okay? Well, actually, righteous means always doing what is right. It's being morally and spiritually upright. Righteous means all, it means the condition of being acceptable to God, which actually is a prerequisite for attaining God's approval. And so the Bible brings righteousness to Christians in two different ways. First of all, righteousness, that which makes us approved by God, is a free gift given to us because of what Jesus did on the cross. Very important. You see, the cross was necessary because God was a perfect being, and he can't have anything to do with people who are sinful. And so when humans brought sin into the world because we wanted to run our lives rather than let God tell us what to do, that rendered us unacceptable. That made everybody a sinner so that none are righteous, not even one. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so this is a problem, because we could never make ourselves acceptable to God. And today, lots of people think that all they need to do to get to heaven and be with God is live a comparatively decent life. I was shocked to learn that 60% of Christians believe all you have to do is be good to make it to heaven. You can imagine how the secular world feels. And I'm sure that they would admit, oh, you know, I have a little bad thought, bad word here or there. And most would give themselves a 90 percentile range of being pretty good people. But here's the problem. We follow the rules when it's to our advantage. Take, for instance, driving down the highway. Has anybody here ever gone faster than the speed limit? That is a violation. And we know that, but we justify it. Well, I was in a hurry. And basically, we say, if the rule fits my need, I'll abide by it. But if not, well, who's to say what's best for me anyways? And when you get pulled over because you were going 85 miles per hour, well, you know you're guilty. You expect to get a ticket. The challenge is when you get pulled over and you were going 56 miles an hour in the 55 mile an hour zone. You start to get an attitude. I mean, technically I was wrong, but come on. You know, there's a Bible verse in James chapter 2 that says, if we obey almost all of the laws and fail at one, we're guilty before God. That one sin causes you a problem with God. Now, I have to tell you, when I was a kid, I used to like the James Bond movies. I used to watch Mission Impossible. The characters were always so suave, resourceful, capable of escaping danger and death with skill and ingenuity. And then there was this other guy named Maxwell Smart. Supremely confident in his own abilities, assuming that he could save mankind from chaos. But what was he always saying? Missed it by that much. You know, a California research firm did an advertisement for a soap that was 99.4% pure. And they began to wonder, what if everything operated on a 99% efficiency rate? Well, they discovered that drinking water would be unsafe 1 hour out of each month, that two planes would crash land each day at Chicago's O'Hare Airport, that 500 surgeries would be botched each week, and that 20,000 prescriptions would be improperly filled each year. 99% efficiency. It wouldn't be acceptable in these important matters because just 1% wrong would be deadly. Well, I'd like to apply this to eternity. That 1%. Now, I used to be invited by my friends to parties, and they always thought it was fun to invite one of their fundamentalist Baptist friends to come along. And this guy would follow me along the party the whole time. And, well, he would basically tell me, "You're going to hell, Presbyterians. You think it's okay to drink alcohol. And you have women as pastors." And he'd lecture me the whole time. He was the self-appointed sin watchdog. And what always bothered me was I noticed that what he demanded was skewed with his own interpretations. And so, of course, you know me, I would have to mess with him. "Hey, you know, I noticed that Jesus told the rich young ruler that you have to sell all your things to follow him. Have you sold all of your stuff yet?" Well, it's the only way I could get him to quit following me around. But on a serious note, people would say, "You know, when I clean up my act, then I'm going to make it to God." But friends, I want you to know you're never going to get to that point. And that's because all of us have the sin virus that has one inoculation. And whether you're a person who sinned a lot or sinned a little, God is making an incredible offer to you. He wants to absorb your sins so that you can have a relationship with Him. And you see, you don't have enough righteousness to appease Him, but He wants to be close to you. So here's the deal. Jesus, who was part of God, the one who had no sin, He went to the cross and He transferred His perfect obedience that we lacked and is required by God to us. And He took all of our sin. And so now you and I can have a relationship with our Creator. You see, this is what God wanted from the beginning, for you and Him to be close. And so now when God sees us, He doesn't see our bad sins. All He sees is His Son's perfect righteousness. You might say, if ever the phrase, it's who you know, mattered, it's right here. But friends, this isn't the end of the gift of righteousness. You see, God makes us in right standing with Himself, but He also releases power over sin into our lives. You see, sin always ruins us and makes our relationships broken and you know, destroys everything. And the challenge is to transition from the old self into the new self. And because we have sin, our hearts, they never can really achieve God's goodness. What we need is divine assistance. And I have some good news for you. When you invite Jesus into your life, He releases the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 3:16, do you not know that the Holy Spirit dwells within you? This Spirit, it renews us. It inclines us to please God. You know, back in Ezekiel chapter 36, God said, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I'll give you my spirit and cause you to walk in my statutes. You see, friends, this is how it works. Whenever we're inclined to sin, the Holy Spirit inside of us says, wait a minute, don't say that, don't think that, don't do that. Make this choice instead. When somebody rubs you the wrong way and you're ready to react negatively, it's the Holy Spirit who says, no, we do things with compassion and patience. And friends, this is where you and I cooperate with God. And Proverbs 4:23 says, watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flows the springs of life. See, God set it up inside of each one of us that we can and should enjoy life. But to do that, we have to guard what we let into our heads and hearts. Okay? Whether it comes in through our eyes, our ears, our thoughts, anything that our minds feed on, it can quench the Spirit's renewal when you let bad stuff into your heads. And Romans chapter 8 states, those who are of the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. Those who are of the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. And here's why it matters. The things of the flesh lead to death. The things of the Spirit lead to life. So if you don't want to be dominated by your old sinful nature that keeps ruining your relationships and robbing you of joy, well, all you have to do is say, Holy Spirit of Jesus, come into me and redirect my path. And friends, you know, I'm always leaning on you to read the Bible, because the Bible's the way that God gets into our lives. A chapter a day. You read a chapter a day, and what you're doing is building a library that the Holy Spirit can pull that information out and guide you as you go through your everyday. Okay? It's by that word and by that Spirit that you and I can enjoy that right living with God. And now that we know what righteousness is, I want to connect it to the breastplate in our spiritual battle. You see, the way Satan tries to conquer us is by controlling our hearts. He tries to resurrect the old self and feed our sinful nature. He tempts us to get offended by somebody, or to be selfish, or let anger rule our attitudes. In fact, Satan has two chief weapons. One is self-righteousness, and the other is despair. And self-righteousness is when we're enticed to become proud, thinking, you know, God ought to be pretty excited about me, the way I've overcome my problems, the way I don't sin anymore. I don't live like the people around me. Okay? That's a self-righteous attitude. It's a Phariseeism that Jesus got so angry with. You're not supposed to think like that. And the fact is, the goodness that comes out of us and pleases God, it's not really based on our good deeds. What matters to God is when Christ's Spirit is allowed to flow through us. Okay? I mean, good deeds is what we're supposed to do. Luke 17:10 says, when we do something good, we're to say, I've only done what I should have been doing. Okay? Yes, you ought to be a good person. But, friends, human standards of goodness, they're different from God's standards. You know, this one woman met the pastor after church, and she said, you know what, that's the best sermon that you've ever done. And the humble pastor couldn't accept such a compliment, and he said, oh, it wasn't me, it was the Lord. And she retorted, oh, no, it wasn't that good. Okay? See, there's a difference when we're good, and there's a difference when the Lord's on the move. And friends, spiritual power can flow through us when we let the divine control our lives. That's when the miraculous occurs and we release Christ's touch and we release Christ's words. It's when you and I live in dependence upon God's presence. That righteousness that makes us worthy before the Lord is also a tool that makes us team up with God. And pride, it never really enters the picture because our entire standing depends on Jesus. You see, self-righteousness is when we think, you know, I can handle it myself. No, you can't. You're tainted by sin. You need God's help. And this whole idea that if you measure up and meet the righteousness standards, you can have an audience with God. Well, first of all, that's what all religions are based on, other than Christianity. And second of all, in 1 Timothy 4, Paul calls it the doctrine of demons. Because it takes away from what Christ did and puts the emphasis on us instead of him. And I was reading about a cake mix. It hit the market, and the instructions were, all you have to add is water and bake it. But it wasn't selling. And so they did some research, and they discovered that people were skeptical about it because it only needed to have water added. And so the company altered the formula. They said, not only do you add water, but you have to add an egg as well. All of a sudden, boom, sales jumped dramatically. Why? It was too easy. And I think that's how many people perceive God's free gift of salvation. You know, surely we have to do something to get God's favor. Actually, friends, it's that easy. God loves you. You had a problem with sin. He took care of it so that you can now enjoy a relationship with him. And it's when you and I are trying our best to please God and failing, and then we get all full of despair and get discouraged, and, you know, we get discouraged. Satan's right there to say, that's right, you failed again. God doesn't want somebody like you. You're a bad person. Just look what you've done. You're never going to make it. Friends, all those thoughts are hung on the cross where Jesus has taken that weight from us. You see, the breastplate of righteousness, it protects us from the flaming arrows that try to drive a barrier between us and God. So whenever you're bombarded with condemnation thoughts, just remember, I'm covered by Jesus. He made me good enough. He provides me unhindered access to the throne of mercy. I say remember this. You know, we tend to forget a lot of things. I was reading John Hopkins did a research study, and that the top five things that people most often forget: one, names, 83%. Two, where something is, I can't find it, 60%. Telephone numbers, 57%. We forget words, 53%. We forget faces, 42%. In fact, if you can't remember what I just said, you'd join 49% of the population. But the next time you hear those negative thoughts, this is what I want you to do. Say, yes, I am not perfect, but I belong to Jesus who covered my failures. I don't count on my own abilities to measure up. I lean on what Jesus has done for me. Just tell Satan, you know, before you overwhelm me with fear and despair, find something wrong with Jesus. In fact, when the devil tells you of your past, you remind him of his future. Okay? Because he's a defeated foe, and you're a forgiven soul. Remember, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If God is for you, who could be against you? You know, I was reading about this one company called Second Chance Body Armor. They make bulletproof vests. All kinds of police departments throughout the nation are buy these and use them. And apparently several policemen were killed using these vests, and they did some tests and found out that these vests actually don't stop bullets. It turns out the company was aware of these defects, but sold them anyways. And so they sent out an apology for any inconvenience that these faulty vests may have caused anybody for not working. And I don't know about you, but when dealing with something as serious as a bulletproof vest, you know, what's the margin of error that's acceptable? No margin, right? When someone's shooting at you, you want to know that what you're wearing is going to work. And friends, what Jesus offers us, eternal protection, you don't have to be afraid that it won't work, because he's already tried it and he resurrected from the dead. You and I know that it works. And friends, I want you to hear me. This whole righteousness, it happens in the conversation that we keep with Jesus. It's that conversation with the Lord that keeps us in the right place. You know, a pastor visited a man in the hospital who had a serious condition. And he said to the man, "Are you ready to meet God?" And the gentleman said, "You know, I'm scared. I don't really know how to talk to God." And the pastor said, "You know, it's as easy as talking to a friend. Just tell him whatever's on your heart. In fact, you see this chair right next to your bed? Just imagine that Jesus is sitting there, and talk to him the way you would talk to any one of your friends." Well, pastor came back for another visit a few days later and was informed that the man had passed on the night before. And his daughter was sharing, "You know, it was the weirdest thing. My dad had moved off of his bed onto his knees with his head in the seat of the chair right next to the bed." See, friends, it's that conversation that gets us through this life and leads us into the next. And you might miss being sinless by just a little, but I don't want you to miss belonging to God by any measure. If you want to be his, he's made a way for you to have a relationship with him that's 100% secure. I guess what I'm telling you is, you can be a righteous dude. Actually, Christian, you are a righteous dude and dudette because of Jesus. Amen? Amen? Kids, come up and let's close up with our final song.
Awesome word was that. Dudettes and dudes. I'm a dude. If you guys can stand, we'll get into our last worship.
Splendor of my King, Godhead, the God of three in one. Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. Great is our God. Say with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how great is our God. Name above all names.
Touched your heart. It has been a joy for us to lead worship today. As we part, remember this: Jesus Christ stands at the door of your heart, and he knocks. If anyone hears his voice and opens the door, he will come in and have dinner with you, and you will have dinner with him. This is his promise.
Amen. Susan McDowell, Joanne Tennant, children, thank you so much for this incredible worship service. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Amen.